Hallelujah and blessings in Jesus, friends. Welcome back to Haya Kadosh Ministries, where holiness is a way of life. Jesus is truly King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Holy Bible is our only standard and authority for truth. And together God's people say, Hallelujah. Well, friends, I trust this finds you feeling blessed in Jesus this morning. Now, we're continuing our story through the journey of the Bible, and today we see that Jacob is going to take a wife for himself. He marries Rachel in chapter 29, and Rachel's father is a man named Laban. Now, you have to remember, Jacob, his name means deceiver. And what we're going to see through this story is you reap what you sow. What comes around goes around. And so as Jacob has deceived his brother Esau, Jacob is now going to become the recipient of deception. In verse 14 of chapter 29, Laban, Rachel's father, says to Jacob, "Surely thou art my bone and my flesh." And in verse 15, Laban said unto Jacob, "Because you are my bone, my flesh, it is not right for you to work for me without pay. So tell me what your wages are to be." And Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah. The name of the younger was Rachel. Now Leah was tender-eyed, which means that she just wasn't appealing to the eye. But Rachel was beautiful and well-favored. Now Jacob loved Rachel. And so he tells Laban, Rachel's father, "I will serve you 7 years if you will give Rachel to me to be my wife." And Laban says, "It's better that I give her to thee, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, than that I should give her to another man. So abide with me these 7 years, work for me these 7 years, and I'll do as you've asked." And so in verse 20, Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed unto him but a few days for the love he had to her. And at the end of 7 years, Jacob said unto Laban, "Give me my wife, for the days of my wages are fulfilled, so that I may go in unto her." Now Laban gathered together all the men of the place, and he made a great feast. And it came to pass in the evening that he took Leah his daughter, not Rachel, and brought her to him, and Jacob went in unto Leah. Now it came to pass in verse 25 that in the morning Jacob realized it was Leah. And he said unto Laban, "What is this thou hast done unto me? Did I not serve thee for Rachel? Where have you tricked me? Why have you beguiled me? Why have you deceived me?" And Laban said, "It must not be so done in our country, to give the younger before the firstborn." In other words, it's our custom to give the firstborn before we give the younger. "Give me another 7 years, and I will give you Rachel." And so in one verse, 28, 7 years go by. And Jacob served Laban those 7 years. And then Laban gave him Rachel, his daughter, to wife. And he went in unto Rachel, and he loved Rachel more than Leah, because he had chosen Rachel to be his wife long ago, the one he loved long ago. And he served him another 7 years. So a total of 21 years he has served Laban, and he's been away from his home country, his brother Esau. Now remember, it was the intent of Jacob's mother, Rebekah, that over time Esau would forget how Jacob had tricked him out of his blessing. Well, throughout the period of these 7 years, Rachel, Leah, and their handmaids are going to have children. And these children are going to become the fathers, the leaders of the 12 tribes of Israel. And that's what we see from the remainder of these verses, 31 to 35, and then throughout the chapter of chapter 30. And if you're familiar with the 12 tribes of Israel, you'll recognize these names. In verse 32 of chapter 29, we have Reuben. Verse 33, we have Simeon. Verse 34, Levi. Verse 35, Judah, which is the line that Jesus came from. In chapter 30, verse 6, we have Dan. Verse 8, Naphtali. Verse 11, Gad. Verse 13, Asher. Verse 18, Issachar. Verse 20, Zebulun. And none of these children at this point have come from Rachel. But in verse 22, it says, "God remembered Rachel, and God hearkened to her, and he opened her womb. And he gave her a son named Joseph." Now, these would be the 11 tribes, if you skip over to chapter 35, verse 18, as Rachel is passing away, she has another son, and his name is called Benjamin. And these will become the 12 tribes of Israel. Well, in the remaining verses of chapter 30, Jacob is going to go back to his old ways. And so he's going to deceive Laban through by using his cattle. And the chapter ends in verse 33 by saying, he increased exceedingly and had much cattle, maidservants, men servants, camels, and asses. Jacob now becomes aware that Laban is beginning to figure out the deception. And in chapter 31, verse 2, it says, Jacob beheld the countenance of Laban, and it was not toward him as before. And so the Lord says unto Jacob, return unto the land of your fathers. Go home. And so Jacob calls Rachel unto him and lets him know that he's about to flee. He says in verse 7, your father has deceived me. He's changed my wages 10 times, but God has suffered him not to hurt me. In verse 5, God has taken away the cattle of your father and has given the best to me. And so as Jacob is gathering all his things to make his journey back to his homeland, in verse 17, it says, Jacob rose up, set his sons and his wives upon camels. He carried away all his cattle, all his goods which he had gotten, the cattle of his getting, which he had gotten in Paddan Aram, to go back to Isaac his father in the land of Canaan. But in verse 19, Rachel has stolen the images that were her father's. Now, we've talked about this before, but let me briefly point this out. It seemed to be a custom of the people of that day that they had what they considered household gods. And the reason that they had these gods was because God, the eternal God, the Almighty, was much too busy to be involved in petty matters. So where a petty matter was the issue, maybe rain for the flock or a household item that had been lost, they wouldn't bother the Almighty with such trivial issues, but they would pray to these smaller gods, their household gods, to provide for them what it was they were asking for. And so in verse 20, we see that Jacob stole away. He left at a time when Laban was not aware that he was leaving, because Jacob did not tell him that he was leaving. And in verse 22, it was told Laban on the third day that Jacob had fled. And so Laban begins to pursue Jacob, and he overtakes him in the Mount Gilead. Now God, in verse 24, came to Laban the Syrian in a dream by night and said unto him, take heed that you do not speak to Jacob either good or bad. So Laban overtook Jacob, and Laban said unto Jacob, what have you done? Why have you left without telling me and taken away my daughters? If you had told me, I would have sent you on your way merrily, with mirth and with songs, with tabret and with harp. We would have celebrated the day of your leaving. You would not have burnt any bridges behind you. But you didn't even give me a chance to kiss my sons and my daughters. And in doing this, you did foolishly. Now in verse 29, it is in my power to hurt you. But the Almighty, the God of your father, spake unto me yesternight, saying, take heed that you do not speak to Jacob either good or bad. And now, though thou wouldest needs be gone, because thou sore longest after thy father's house, why have you stolen my gods? And obviously Jacob isn't aware of this. So he says unto Laban, because I was afraid. This is why I left without telling you. I feared that you would take your daughters by force from me, but they're my wives. I worked for them. I earned them. But with whomsoever you find your gods, kill him on the spot. Let them not live. Do it here before our brethren, and then take your gods back with you. And so Laban, in verse 33, went into Jacob's tent. He went into Leah's tent, and he went into the two maidservants' tents, but he did not find the gods. Then he went into Rachel's tent. Now Rachel had taken the images and put them in the camel's furniture. And so she sat upon them on the camel. And as Laban searched the tent, yet he did not find the gods. And so Rachel, realizing that Laban's next act will be to search the camels, she said unto her father, let it not displease my lord that I cannot rise up before thee, for the custom of women is upon me. In other words, she was having her monthly cycle. And he searched, but he did not find the images. Now Jacob was angry, and he said unto Laban, "What is my trespass? What is my sin that you have so hotly pursued after me?" Well, Jacob is certainly wrong because he's deceived Laban. But Laban's wrong because he's deceived Jacob. And Rachel's wrong because she's deceived both Jacob and Laban. And so we see a myriad of different events here where everyone is deceiving the other. And this is a drama that would make for a great 2-hour blockbuster movie. And so Jacob says in verse 37, "You've searched everything that I have. Now what you have found, set it before us so that we can discern who is right in this circumstance and who is wrong. 20 years I've been with you. I've taken care of your cattle. Those who were killed, I held not at your expense. I took it out of my own pocket. In the day, the drought consumed me, and the frost by night. Many nights lied I awake, watching your flocks. I've been in your house 20 years. I've served you 14 years for your 2 daughters, 6 years for your cattle, and you've changed my wages 10 times. Except the God of my father, the God of Abraham, and the fear of Isaac had been with me, surely you would have sent me away empty. But God has seen mine affliction, the labor of my hands, and he has rebuked you." And notice what Laban says in verse 33. He said unto Jacob, "These daughters that you're speaking of, they are my daughters, and the children are my children, and these cattle are my cattle, and all you see before you is mine." That must have had something to do with the custom of that day, because I can't understand how Laban would make such a claim, because Laban's 2 daughters now belong to Jacob, and so their offspring, and so the cattle that Jacob has worked for. But Laban, realizing that this argument is not going to be won by either side, says in verse 44, "Let us make a covenant. Let us agree to disagree. Let us make a peace treaty between us so that no bridges are burnt." And so Jacob, in order to memorialize this event, took a stone and set it up for a pillar. And Jacob said unto his brethren, "Gather stones." And so they took stones. They made a heap. And they made a feast, and they feasted there upon that heap. And Laban said unto Jacob and all the others, "This heap is a witness between me and thee this day. The Lord watch between me and thee, that he will keep us while we are apart. And let this heap be as a witness between me and thee, that I will not cross over to harm thee, and you will not cross over to harm me." And so in verse 53, Jacob swore by the fear of his father Isaac, that he would honor the agreement. And Jacob offered sacrifice upon the mount. He called his brethren to eat bread. They did eat bread, and they tarried all night in the mount. And early in the morning, Laban rose up, kissed his sons and his daughters. He blessed them, and he departed and returned unto his place. And what we learn from this story, friends, is that honesty is always the best way. Dishonesty and deception only leads to bigger problems. And what we also see is it not only affects us, but it bleeds over and affects the lives of others. For where do you think Rachel learned her deceptive ways other than Jacob, her husband? And Jacob learned them from his father, Isaac. Isaac learned them from his father, Abraham, because he lied when he said that Sarah was his sister. And yet behind all of this deception, all of these lies, God is working his plan, and we see that through the 12 children that have been born unto Rachel, Leah, and their handmaids. And these 12 children are going to become the key players throughout the rest of the story of the history of the people of Israel, all the way up until the very day in which we live today. And what I think the Bible wants to drive home for us in this story is that oftentimes we're very aware of the blatant lie, but how often do we use deception to get what we want? But we must be very careful, understanding that even in the slightest of deceptions, the ramifications are severe. And although all things will work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose, and God is busily working out something that began so bad for good, it still has a huge impact on our lives and on all those around us. So if we've used these forms of deception in the past, we most likely cannot go back and change those things. But we can be very careful to make sure that we don't use such practices in the future. And if you're like me, most often when these events occur, we're not even fully aware that they're taking place until it's already too late to do anything about it. And that's why we have to be so aware of what it is that is going on within us at all times. And when we become aware that deception is raising its ugly head, we take control of the situation immediately and put an end to it. Well, we're going to close there today, friends, and I truly trust and pray that you've been challenged through our time together today, and that you'll be honest and forthright in all your affairs before men and before God. Now, as He wills, and until next time, friends, I truly love you, and I'll see you on the next video. Thank you.